As we see our world turning further and further away from the truth of God's Word, one of the results that we see of that, or one of the maybe the symptoms that we see of that, is that we see more and more broken homes. We see families where parents and children don't have the relationships that they once did. We see many problems that stem in adulthood that stem from problems in childhood because of a lack of good relationship within the family. It's something that we see in our culture, that we see across the board, as many people have a desire for a good parent-child relationship, but we see that broken down more and more today as we move further away from the truth of God's Word. But as we continue our series in working through the book of 1 John, we're going to be looking at 1 John chapter 3 this morning, and looking at the relationship that we have with our Heavenly Father. And the fact that we don't have to wonder where we stand with Him. That we can have the right kind of relationship with Him as our Father. That doesn't have to be a broken relationship. But how can we know that we have that sort of relationship? Well, that's what 1 John chapter 3, what we're going to be looking as we work our way through this entire chapter this morning. We're going to be looking at what does it take to be a child of God? What does it take to be in good standing with Him? What does it take for us to be able to have confidence in our relationship with Him? And there are several things that we're going to see, several things that we have to live up to. Because as in any family, God's family has standards. And there are certain ways that we have to live in order to be what He's called us to be, for that relationship to be what we would like for it to be. As was just read for us, the first three verses of 1 John 3, see how great a love the Father has bestowed on us that we would be called children of God, and such we are. For this reason, the world doesn't know us because it didn't know Him. Beloved, we are children of God, and it's not appeared as to what we will be, but we know that when He appears, we will be like Him, because we will see Him just as He is. And everyone who has this hope fixed on Him purifies himself just as He is pure. We can know that we're children of God if we don't fit in with the world. We can have that father-child relationship with Him that we would want to have. But it requires that we be different than what's going on in the world, because we live in a society today that calls good evil and evil good, that has rebelled against God's standards. And so whenever we don't fit in with what's going on out there, when we purify ourselves, as it says here, we can know that we're fitting in more with Him. We don't fit in with the world because as God's children, the standard He calls us to is very different. But notice here, he starts off, see how great a love the Father has bestowed on us. What kind of love is it that He would call us, that He would even allow us such a status that we could call out to Him as Father, that we could be called His children? As those who have sinned, as those who've rebelled against Him, it's a testament to His great love, a testament to how good He is as our Father. But as children of God, we are to resemble Christ in our character, in our language, in our behavior, in the way that we treat people. We are to resemble Him because being a child of God means that we can't fit in with what's going on out there. What God calls us to, the kind of behavior that He calls us to, is a foreign concept to the world. In the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 9 and following, we see that Jesus didn't fit in with the world. If we're going to follow Him, we won't either. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through Him. And the world did not know Him. He came to His own, and those who were His own did not receive Him. But as many received Him, He gave them the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in His name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And so it's those who accept Him, those who live by His standards, those who receive Him, have the right, have the privilege of being children of God. But it means that we don't fit in with what's going on out there. Chapter 15 of the Gospel of John as well, verses 18 through 21, We see a little bit more of how the world didn't receive Jesus. Jesus said to his disciples here, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you're not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, because of this the world hates you. Remember the word I said to you, a slave is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. But all these things they will do to you for my name's sake, because they do not know the one who sent me." The world hated Jesus, and if we are his, if we are his children, if we are his followers, if we are part of his family, it's going to treat us the same way. We can know that we're children of God when we don't fit in with the world. That's one of the markers. As a matter of fact, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12, all those who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. It doesn't say might be, but will be. Children of God will not fit in with the evil that our world puts forth. The children of God will not fit in with the messages that our world proclaims. The children of God will not fit in with the behavior that we see around us. If we're his, 1 John chapter 2 and verse 6, we are obligated to live like him. The one who says he abides in him ought himself to walk in the same way that he walked. If he didn't fit in, neither will we. We know that we're children of God, and one of the markers of that is we don't fit in with what's around us. But in our text, it says, "Beloved, now we're children of God, and it's not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, that we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is. And everyone who has this hope fixed on him purifies himself just as he is pure." Just as our behavior doesn't fit in with the world, our eternity is not going to be the same as the world's either. We don't fit in with where the rest of the world is headed. We'll be raised to be like Christ. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20 and 21 says that our citizenship is in heaven, from which we eagerly await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 21 says that he's going to transform us to be like him. We're waiting for something. We have an eternity to look forward to. We have eternity in the presence of God to look forward to, where our citizenship is, where our Savior is. That's not where most of the world is headed. As children of God, we don't fit in with the world. As children of God, he calls us to be different. He calls us to be pure. Because of this hope, because of this eternity, because of what we have to look forward to, everyone who has this hope fixed on him. And that word hope there in our New Testament is a confident expectation, is what the word means that it's translated from. Something we look forward to. Everyone who has this hope, who has this expectation, who has this future, who has this confidence of being with him and like him, will purify himself just as he is pure. There's the motivation. I have something to look forward to, therefore I'm motivated to conform myself to him. I have something to look forward to, therefore I'm motivated to live differently. I have a confident expectation, therefore I'm not afraid of what the world's going to throw at me. I'm not afraid of being rejected by the world. As a matter of fact, we would expect it. As children of God, we don't fit in with the world because we're different than the world. We can know that we're his children when we don't fit in with what's going on out there, when the world rejects us as it rejected him. We can know that we're his children, picking up our reading in verse 4. We don't live like the rest of the world. It rejected him because his lifestyle was different. Verse 4, "Everyone who practices sin also practices lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has seen him or knows him. Little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. No one who is born of God practices sin, because his seed abides in him, and he cannot sin, for he who is born of because he is born of God. By this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor the one who does not love his brother. We can know that we're his children when our lifestyle is different from the rest of the world. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 19 tells us whose influence the world is under. We know that we are of God, and that the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. The world is under the power and the influence of Satan. It doesn't take too much observation to figure that out. As you look at the way our culture is going, as you look at the inconsistency of culture, as you look at the way the message changes, as you look at the immorality that's going on, you look at the message, you look at the behavior, you look at the language, the world is under the power of the evil one. And so just as the world doesn't know us, those in sin don't know Jesus. Verse 6, no one who abides in him sins, and no one who sins has seen him or knows him. Those who are in Christ don't live in sin. It's against their very identity. It's against who we're called to be. And the idea there that we see in this text is the idea of living in sin, practicing sin, abiding in sin, remaining in sin. If we are in Christ, we cannot live in that which he died to destroy. And we can know that we are his when our lifestyle lines up with him rather than the world. Now he tells them here in verse 7, little children, don't let anyone deceive you. That's exactly what false teachers had come in and were trying to do. John is writing to refute false teachings of the Gnostics, saying we have something extra, we have special knowledge that you need to understand. They were making sin out as though it was no big deal. And John here is writing to make sure that the faithful understand sin is a very big deal. As a matter of fact, lifestyle, whether one practices sin or righteousness, is how you can tell who they belong to. Don't let anyone deceive you, he says. That's exactly what some were trying to do. The false teachers said that whatever happened in the flesh didn't really matter. Sin doesn't matter. Who someone follows can be observed in lifestyle. Someone practicing sin, John says, that person is of the devil. Someone who practices righteousness, that person is of God. And he points out, here's what Satan has done. Satan has sinned from the beginning. He is the father of lies. It's as Jesus said, when Satan lies, when he speaks a lie, he's speaking from his own nature. He is a liar and the father of lies. Jesus came to destroy Satan, or came to destroy Satan's works. How can we live in that which Jesus came to destroy if we claim to be children of God? It doesn't work. You can't sin intentionally. You can't keep on living in sin and expect for things to be okay between you and God. In Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 26, he says, if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much severer punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified, and has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It's a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. So do we practice sin or do we practice righteousness? As John wrote in our text in verse 10, 1 John 3 and verse 10, by this, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor the one who does not love his brother. Who you follow is obvious. You pay attention to someone, you can tell whose standard they're living by. You can tell who they're following after. What are they practicing? But we can also take a look and we need to examine our own selves in that same way. What am I practicing? Am I practicing immorality? What is my language like? How do I treat others? Do I love my brothers and sisters? By inspiration, John says, the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. How are we living? We can know that we're His children. Picking up on what He says there at the end about loving. When we love one another. Picking up in verse 11. This is the message which you've heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Not as Cain, who was of the evil one and slew his brother. For what reason did he slay him? Because his deeds were evil and his brothers were righteous. Do not be surprised, brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brethren. He who does not love abides in death. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoever has the world's goods and sees his brother in need and closes his heart against him, how does the love of God abide in him? Little children, let us not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and truth. We will know by this that we are of the truth and will assure our hearts before him in whatever our heart condemns us. For God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him because we keep his commandments and do the things which are pleasing in his sight. This is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. The one who keeps his commandments abides in him, and he in him. We know by this that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. We can know that we're children of God when we show the love of Christ to one another. Now he starts off with the example there of Cain, of selfishness. Example of a lack of love. Or maybe you might would say that he loved himself but hated his brother. He was overcome by jealousy. It was all about me. For Cain. Here's the example not to follow. But then he goes on, verse 14. We know that we've passed out of death into life because we love the brethren. We know, he says. John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. What we see in 1 John here, we know we've passed from death to life by our love for the brethren. Jesus said in John 13, 34 and 35, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you. By this all men will know you are my disciples. How we can know that we are of Christ and have passed from death to life is by our love for the brethren. Jesus says the way that the world knows that you follow me is by your love for the brethren. The way that we can know that we are of him, the way that we can know that we're his. Jesus didn't say, by your cleverness, by your politics, by your finances. He said, by your love. John writes, we know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brethren, because we're following the example of Christ. Verse 15, everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. No murderer has eternal life living in him. He goes to the opposite side of that. If you hate, he says, you're a murderer, you have no eternal life. And Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 and 22 tells us that murder begins in the heart. Jesus said, you've heard that it was said, you shall not commit murder. But Jesus takes it a step further there in Matthew chapter 5. I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother, because that's where the murder begins. And that's exactly the idea that the Apostle John is writing about here. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. What's in the heart? Verses 16 and following. John tells us how we know what love is. Okay, he's been giving this command, you love one another. This is how you can know that you're of Christ. This is how you know you have life, if you love one another. But what is love? Well, John takes the time next to define it. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Love is defined in an action and is shown in an action. It's a love that puts others first. It's what Paul was trying to get across to the Philippian church in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and following, when he's telling them, don't do anything from selfishness or empty conceit, but in humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. And he goes on in verses 5 and following, have this attitude, have this mind in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, that he put others first. This was a selfless type of love, and it's what John is writing about here. We know love by this. What? Because Jesus laid his life down. Because Jesus humbled himself, as Paul wrote in Philippians, to the point of death, even death on a cross. Love is defined by an action, and it's shown in action. This is a love that puts others first. We can have confidence before God when we're following after his example in that. Because of this, verse 22, we can have confidence that he hears us, and whatever we ask, that he hears us, that he answers, because, verse 22, we keep his commandments and we do the things that are pleasing in his sight. And his command. We have confidence in our standing with him. We have confidence that we're his children. We have confidence that he hears when we call out. We have confidence that he answers when we call out to him, Father. Because we obey him. And what is it that we obey? He answers. This is his commandment, verse 23, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. That we put our trust in him. That we put our faith in him. And that involves obedience to the gospel. It involves a number of things. And that we love one another just as he's commanded us. The one who keeps his commandments. The one who lives at Christ's word. The one who, as 1 John 1, 7 says, walks in the light. Lives at the word of Christ. Abides in him, and he in him. And the idea there is the one who is the child of God abides in Christ, and Christ lives in the one who follows him. And he dwells in us through his Spirit, which John makes reference to. We don't have to wonder about our standing with God. And that's one of the things that's so wonderful about this book. We don't have to wonder about our relationship with him. We can know that we're his. We can know that we're saved. We can know that we're his children when we behave as Jesus did, when we treat people with love and the forgiveness of Christ. And that's a way that the world doesn't understand. That's a lifestyle the world doesn't understand. And it'll make it so that we don't fit in. When we treat people well who haven't treated us in the same way, the world doesn't understand, but it makes us children of God. When we live this way, we don't have to wonder. You know, we look around in our world, and what we see is broken homes. We see broken relationships. We see families that have been split apart. We see relationships that have gone wrong. But when we look at our Heavenly Father, when we live by what He's called us to, we don't have to wonder if He accepts us. We don't have to wonder if he's saved us. We don't have to wonder if he loves us. We don't have to wonder if he hears us. When we call out to him, we can know. See how great a love the Father has bestowed on us, that we would be called children of God. And I love that next statement that John makes. And such we are. There's no question mark behind that, but a period. This is a statement of fact. We can have confidence. We can know. And he accepts anyone who will come to him and put their faith in Jesus Christ, that you can be His child and have confidence in your standing before Him. This morning we're going to offer an invitation. If you would like to be a part of the family of God, to have a Father who loves you more than you can grasp, who accepts you, who will save you, who will hear and answer when you call out to Him, you have that opportunity this morning by putting your faith in Christ. These are His commandments, that you believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. That you come putting your faith and your trust in Jesus, that's demonstrated through turning away from sin and being united with Him in the waters of baptism. If you'll come this morning, you can be His child. Or if as His child you've wandered away, He stands ready to forgive and reconcile if you'll come back. You have that opportunity today, and if we can assist you in that, would you come while we stand and while we sing?